Welcome to worship on this Lord's Day. Our scripture today is from the 5th chapter of Matthew, verses 13 through 16. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Last year, we launched a disciple train as our pathway to being disciples of Jesus Christ. Once adopted, we introduced the disciple train through a 7-week sermon series. We then held a foundations class that introduced the fundamentals of Christian practice. We're nearing the end of the discipler group, which has invested 24 weeks in deepening our practice of Christianity across all 6 dimensions of discipleship. We've launched an online simplified approach to covenant Bible study, looking at the covenant which God has made with us humans that across 24 weeks has given us a glimpse into the majority of the Bible. It is time to touch base now with our disciple train pathway once again, as decisions are made about which classes we offer this next in this fall. In our call to worship, we spoke of our commitment to being with Jesus in ministry. One of the ways we do this is through a life of service. Through service, we become the salt and light to the world, bringing flavor and illumination to others. In Phil Maynard's work on discipleship, he begins with the principle of looking at the life stages of development and how each of us moves from infancy to childhood, to adolescence, to adulthood, to parenthood. In truth, we can break out adulthood into several categories of age. We know our expectations of a 20-year-old are not the same as those we would hold for a 50-year-old or for an 80-year-old. We can take those same learnings from the life stages of development and transfer them to the journey through the phases of discipleship as we move from exploring Christ's way to beginning new life in Christ, to growing our walk in Christ, to maturing all our life in Christ. When we think about a life of service across the life stages of development, we see a sliding scale that we move across as we grow in Christ. At first, we may be amazed at the way that we see disciples of Jesus serving the needs of others as we first become aware of the concept of service. But as we come to a deeper understanding of the gifts, the talents, and the passion that God has given us, we begin to dabble and we begin to experiment with serving others in different ways. Over time, as we are maturing in our faith, a life of service becomes a natural outpouring of the love of God that we've received in our lives, and we thereby join Jesus in mission. You see, a life of service includes supporting the ministry of the local church with our time and our energy, as well as participating in service projects sponsored by the church. But it also includes a lifestyle of investing the best of who we are in service to others. In the last few weeks, even in the midst of the pandemic, we have members that have supported the ministry of our congregations well. We have gathered online and worshiped. We have connected through the phone and by mail and email. Leaders of the 2 congregations have met online as needed and in person to care for their responsibilities. Members have participated in work days at both churches to care for the landscaping around each church. And the Phillipsville crew welcomed the community for the spring pork dinner by takeout in the parking lot. This fundraiser provides the funding for mission work of the Phillipsville Women's Group. Thank you for your service to our congregation. We have been reminded during these last several weeks that the church is not the building. The church is the people. And as the people of God, we are called to be the hands and feet of Jesus. not just within the doors of the church, but we are called through a life of service to join Jesus in mission to others, using our God-given gifts, talents, and passions. For instance, we have had a handful of persons that have put their sewing skills to work to make over 150 masks for Meadville Medical Center and for EUMA. Over the next few weeks, we will explore some of the ongoing ministries of our congregations that are seeking to join Jesus in mission to others. Each of us, as a disciple of Jesus, are called to live a life of service. And my prayer is that you learn about these ministries, that God may inspire you to find and participate in the ministries that best allow you to serve others through the use of your God-given talents and passion. If you're unsure of your next step, I invite you to reach out to me. It would be my pleasure to coach you in your next steps, living a life of service. And all of God's people said, amen. So today I'm here with Darlene Duda and Joanne Berkey as we are on this trip looking through our mission work. And this one is to look at our Argentina mission trip. So Darlene and Joanne, this past February, you went to Argentina for a mission trip. What organization or ministry are you working with when you go down there?
It's called Logos Global Network. It was established in 1999. And they are the financial backing. That's the place where the money goes to, and they disperse the money to help pay for the tías, which are the house mothers that take care of the children, because the state doesn't pay enough. And to keep good quality people, they supplement what the state pays them to keep the workers there.
Carl Eliason was going for years and years, and I decided to go with him to Argentina, and that's how I started.
So how many years have you been going to Argentina?
I think it's 15, I think.
And were you the first one to go from our congregation?
Yes, in fact, I'm the only one that has gone until Joanne decided to go with me.
And Joanne, how long have you been going?
For 4 years.
What did you get to do this year while you were there?
Love the children.
Yeah,
we get to,
this year the children had a huge fundraiser. It was a big banquet for the whole community, and they raised money to go on a vacation for 7 days. So this year we were able to go on a vacation with the children, and we were doing so many different things that we have never done with them. We went to a river with them. We did crafts. We spent all day and all evening with the children and ate dinner with them and had the same food. And we shared with them, and it made us so much closer to these children that normally we just had them for a couple hours a day, but we had them for all day, and that itself was a joy and a blessing. It was very tiring, more so than before, but just to interact with them as long as we did this time, it was just a blessing.
And what was your best memory of this year's trip?
I know mine was the crafts that we got to do with the older children. And spending the quality time that we did, that was my best memory. And that's something that just will keep me going for next year.
I really enjoyed, when we were on the vacation, you might say, I really enjoyed working with the other adults in the kitchen and having our morning lunch and evening meal with the children. You know, it was really a nice thing to do. I really like that.
So you don't normally get to have interaction with the adults?
Not like we did this time. No, we don't usually. We always have our meals with them, you know, and we have very, very good meals. But that's about really the only time that we are actually with the adults.
Darlene, what other places have you gone on mission trips?
I've gone to West Virginia to a coal mining town. I went there with Lowville United Methodist Church. That was several years ago. I've gone to North Dakota to an Indian reservation. That was with both Wattsburg and Phillipsville Church people. I've gone to Louisiana and Mexico. That I went with the team that Gilbert was in charge of. Prison ministry twice a year. And the biggest ministry that I've done, and I haven't had to go very far, like I've gone to Erie or I've gone down to Wattsburg. You know, there's a lot of things locally that I'm involved in.
Meals on Wheels.
Joanne, how about you? What other mission trips have you gotten to do?
I went to Jamaica for 2 years in a row. Then I got a calling to go to Argentina because Darlene's other traveling friend that she used to go with couldn't go anymore. And I felt called to go to her to Argentina after that. And then I'm the prison ministry, Curex Prison Ministry in Gwanda, New York. And I go twice a year for 4 days each. And we stay up there and we go in the prison on the last day. And we're more of an outsiders group. We're behind the scene people. And we work up there for the 4 days and take care of the gentleman going inside the prison. And I've been doing that for 7 years now.
So as you think about these other experiences that you each have had, what do you like about the Argentina experience that sets it apart from the other trips?
Mine is the children and the hunger that they have just for God's love, for any love, because these are children that have been taken away from their parents because of abuse. They're hurting children. And when they see us and they yell our name, when we run and they run up there and hug us and they're so happy to see us, that's what sets it apart for me.
It's a very, very strong feeling that we have when we go. There's, for instance, the long journey there. That's the reward we get when we're there. It's just very, very heartwarming.
So would there be an opportunity for someone else to join the two of you on this trip?
Absolutely. Anybody's welcome.
And what should a first timer know before they go?
Probably about the flight, how long it takes. I don't know. And once you're there, it's all good. You know, it's all good. You get wonderful meals, and the friendship there is just fantastic. Everybody is so kind and generous, and they just love to see us come. And the children, it's unbelievable. The feelings that you have.
Joanne, you're a little more recent in having been there for your first time. Is there something else that you'd think of that maybe a first timer should know before they go?
Just that we're usually gone for 2 weeks and we have to raise all our own money for the trip ourselves. There's no, some people donate in our church and all the money goes in the one pot, and then we buy our airplane tickets, pay to stay there, such as the expenses of food and utilities that we use. And then we donate the rest of the money that we have to the orphanage. And a lot of times it's for school supplies and shoes or socks that the children need. So it's not a cheap mission trip.
But how much does it cost per person?
Our airline tickets are about $1,100 to $1,400 a piece. And that depends on the time that we buy our tickets. We pay $400 each for staying there and then try to give at least $1,000 for the orphanage themselves.
Always have your own expenses you have to consider also. They do take us to the marketplace where they're all vendors from home. Everything there is what people have made to sell. And we go there, and it's very interesting. It's not like a flea market. it's homemade items.
And when will the next trip be?
Hopefully February. That's if we're
right, allowed. The second week.
Somebody else wants to go with you. What's the process for someone to go?
Just want to do it. There's really no application. There's nothing to do except really want to go. And believe me, they would be very enjoyable for them. They'd really, really like it, I believe.
And how else can we become involved to support you guys and to support this ministry?
Yeah, my thought on that is donations and help with fundraisers if they can, because it's hard for us to do fundraisers with just two people.
Is there anything else that either of you would like to share at this moment?
The only fallback is you can't really get to really know somebody well because you can't speak Spanish. We learned a word here and there as we go, but the sentences that you'd have to say in is just not possible for us. And that's the only thing that's very, very difficult. We do have an interpreter, a young girl. And she's very good. She's very good at it. And she's just a real sweetheart.
And we use Google Translate too.
Well, thank you very much for your time today. And I suppose one other thing we could do is certainly keep you in our prayers as well as you prepare. And especially while you're there. And thank you for being in this ministry.